Welcome to Liberty, Carrie Sheffield.
Thank you, Penny.
I get to work with her with Independent Women's Forum and just amazing work in policy. She's very, very smart. And, you know, you didn't dial it in educationally, right? You went to Harvard, is that right? Yeah?
I did. Yeah. I went to Harvard for my master's.
You know what a Ivy League graduate, a Harvard graduate calls a hardworking Liberty student? Boss. Just saying. Anyway, no, just kidding. I knew you'd like that.
Pardon the pandering. Penny, I love it. No, but because you're right, especially a Christian hardworking woman, because Harvard is a place where there's a lot of knowledge, but there is not a lot of wisdom, sadly. The original motto in Latin for Harvard, it was originally founded to be a school to train clergy. It was the first college in America. And the original motto in Latin was truth for Christ in the church in Latin. And what they did is they chopped that whole rest of the phrase and they just kept that one word, veritas, truth. And that's all it is. They chopped Christ out. And that's what they've done at Harvard University, I'm very sad to say. I will confess, though, I was an agnostic at Harvard, and I was agnostic for about 12 years of my life.
Yeah, so you have an interesting faith journey. Can you share just a little bit with the students?
So, if you all were born and raised in the Christian church, you're actually more advanced in the faith than I am. I'm about 4 years in. It'll be 4 years December 3rd. So praise God. And before that, I was agnostic. And before that, I was Mormon. So I'm 7th, 8th generation Mormon. My ancestors helped to found the Mormon church. My undergraduate degree was Brigham Young University. My master's was Harvard. And Brigham Young has their own form of what you guys do. It's called devotional. There's not a rock guitar anywhere. So when I first...
this is what heaven sounds like. It really is.
But in terms of getting to BYU, that in itself was a faith journey because my father, he wasn't your cookie cutter Mitt Romney. He was a fundamentalist, abusive, controlling, manipulative man. I've been able to forgive him through my walk in Christ. But when I said I want to go away to college, he didn't want me to go away because he said, I'm a prophet. If you leave, you're leaving my prophetic calling that, you know, you're here to support me and my calling. And he raised his right hand to the square and he said, if you go away to college, I prophesy to you in the name of Jesus, you will be raped and murdered if you go to college. So freshman week for you all, yeah. I mean, that's peanuts for what I went through. And so I went to college and I got to BYU and God spoke to me. He got me out of the man-made religion of Mormonism. But then what happened after I graduated, this is where you all need to be convicted, because I graduated and I moved to Washington, D.C., and I joined a mega pastor church, and I had a terrible experience. I was in a women's Bible study, and they actually voted to kick one of the women out of the Bible study because she had gotten in an argument with the Bible study group leader, but her mother was dying of cancer at the time, the one who was voted out, and I was disgusted. I said, these aren't Christians. I said, this is all man-made. I said, Mormonism's man-made, Christianity's man-made, I'm out, dropping the mic, agnostic. So that's what I did for 12 years, and it's a long story of how I found Christ, but I have to say, the more that I studied science, and the more I studied Christianity, the more I believed in Christ. The more I studied Mormonism, the less I believed in Mormonism. And I want to share a book with you all, or an author, his name is Michael Gillen. If you haven't heard of him, he's a scientist, he has three PhDs, math, science, or physics and astronomy. Michael Gillen, look him up. He was an atheist. He became Christian. So I came to God through science and also just through God.
Love that. Yes. Amen. Yes, because first off, God is truth. I hate to break it to Harvard. You can't divorce the truth from God. They're one and the
science.
Same. Or science. That's right. The God we serve is big enough. He created the world. He created the universe. He is all of it. Music, art, all of it is under his subjection. So, Carrie, you're here with these beautiful women. And, you know, here we are out on the public stage. You're on media a lot. And I loved your clip. You're talking about the war on women, which is a term bantied about usually to harass conservatives. But I've started to worry a couple of things in the culture that we've come from a point where we've stopped talking about the objectification of women, because much of it, I think, is starting to come from ourselves, right? You've got OnlyFans, homemade porn. You've got, you know, you've got a culture that, you know, holds up Cardi B and WAP. We know what that stands for, by the way. All of that, not everybody does, but we do. Don't look it up. Don't. But being serious, it's heartbreaking what we're seeing women do to themselves in a swipe left and a swipe right culture. And you're a single woman. So what words do you have to say to the women students about that?
Yeah, well, and especially as someone who came out of agnosticism and lived in the world, I call it my walk in darkness. There are so many powerful forces. We all know them. That's part of why you all came here, because you wanted to escape from that. But those forces are powerful. Anytime you put anything in the place of God, another book I'm going to recommend to you guys, Counterfeit Gods by Tim Keller. Each chapter is a false idol that we worship. I worship them all. It's part of why I became Christian, because I tried everything else. Nothing fulfilled it. So if you are putting yourself on social media, if you are in your own image, worshiping your own image on social media, or you're allowing other people to worship you in your body, This is toxic. I mean, this is why we just heard in the news that the Wall Street Journal reported how Facebook knows that Instagram is toxic for teenage girls, but it's associated with eating disorders, all sorts of social pressures, mental illness. And this is the tension of a free society, and I want to read a verse from Galatians 5:13. It says, "You, my brothers and sisters, were called to be free, but do not use your freedom to indulge the flesh. Rather, serve one another humbly in love." So we live in a free country for now. I mean, we got to keep it free. Mm-hmm. But we can't squander that freedom. We can't indulge the flesh, whether it's us doing it ourselves or allowing other people to, lust after the female body. I mean, that's what Jesus said, to look on a woman in adultery, whether you're participating in as a woman or helping encourage men.
Well, and nothing, listen, you're a daughter of the King. There's no shame for you. Christ took all of that. And if you've stumbled, if you've fallen and scraped your knee, stand up, straighten your crown, and go on, sister. You can walk out that authority that God has given you. And don't settle for less. I mean, a few years ago, there was a book, and again, nothing to read. It's horrible. 50 Shades of Grey, that glorified abuse, sexual abuse. But the truth is, and I want everybody to hear me say this, you deserve, and do not settle for anything less than a man who will stand beside you, who will be your brother in Christ, who will be your husband, will be the father of your children, will support your dreams, and will be, forget 50 Shades of Grey, you deserve 50 years with a man who will stand beside you. Do not settle for less than that. And if you've been you're sitting by somebody you've been dating a couple of years and he won't meet your eyes right now, dump him. It's over.